Hello everyone, this is Nikhil, an assistant professor, Department of Civil Engineering, University of Mangalore. So in my previous video, I had discussed about elements of highway and pavement surface characteristics. So today in this video, I am going to discuss about site distance and horizontal alignment. So firstly, let us start with the site distance. So what is a site distance? So it is the length of road which is visible ahead to the driver at any instance. So sight distance is a length of road which is visible to a driver at any instance of a time. So the sight distance should be proper in order to avoid number of accidents occurring on a highway. So sight distance is a length of road visible ahead to the driver at any instance. So sight distance available at any location of a carriageway is actual distance a driver with his eye level at specified height above the pavement surface has visibility of any stationary or moving object of specific height. So here the sight distance is having some restrictions. So here in this picture you can see a vehicle which is moving on a vertical curve. So here this is the eye of a driver and this is an object which is having a height of h. So a driver who is driving a car at this point is not able to see the object which is at this point because the line of sight of a driver is being obstructed at the intersection of a curve. So this is the obstruction which is caused due to the vertical curve. Similarly, in the second figure, you can see there is a restriction for a sight distance of a driver due to intersection. So here, at an uncontrolled intersection, when a driver from one approach, so a driver from one approach, this vehicle is approaching from this side and this vehicle is approaching from this end. So the driver from one approach of a road is able to sight a vehicle from another approach of a road proceeding towards the intersection. So here the line of sight of this driver will be interrupted by this object, or the line of sight of this driver will be interrupted by the intersection, so that this driver will not be able to see the vehicle which is coming from this approach. So types of sight distance. So there are 5 types of sight distances. So first is SSD, that is stopping or absolute minimum sight distance, safe overtaking or passing sight distance, that is also called as OSD, safe sight distance for entering into uncontrolled intersection, intermediate sight distance and headlight sight distance. So let us see one by one. So first let us see what is a stopping sight distance. So SSD is the minimum sight distance available on a highway at any spot having sufficient length to enable the driver to stop a vehicle traveling at a speed safely without collision with any obstructions. So stopping sight distance means it is a distance which is available for a driver to stop his vehicle at any instant of time without any collision or without any accident involvement. So here a driver, when he sees a vehicle or when he sees an object which is on a way he is moving on, then he should be able to stop the vehicle. So to stop the vehicle, a minimum sight distance has to be provided. So within this minimum sight distance, the vehicle has to come into rest position. So it is called as stopping sight distance. So here the sight distance is dependent upon few factors, that is feature of road ahead, height of driver's eye above the road surface, height of object above the road surface. So the feature of road ahead, which affects the sight distance or horizontal alignment and vertical profile of the road. So as I said you, in previous slide. See here, the road profile is on a vertical curve. So when this is the condition, the line of sight of a driver will be obstructed by this curve. Therefore, a driver is not able to see the object. So that is the feature of road ahead, which is influencing the stopping sight and distance. So second one is height of driver's eye above the road surface. So as per the IRC recommendation for designing of safe stopping sight distance, it is considered that the driver's eye above the road surface is 1.2 meter. It is the standard height of a driver's eye above the road surface as per the IRC recommendation. Similarly, the height of object above the road surface is 0.15 meter. So this is also as per IRC recommendation. The object height should be 0.15 meters on the road, above the road surface, so that the driver can see the object when he is moving on a road surface. So criteria for measurement of stopping sight distance. So here you can see the vertical curve. So a vertical curve of radius r, and here a car is moving on along this road surface and there is an object here and the height of this object is vh. So a driver can see this object when the line of sight of a driver is 1.2 meter and the height of object is 0.15 meter. So only when this condition satisfies, a driver can see the object and he can apply the brake and bring the vehicle to rest position without any collision. So this is the criteria for the measurement of stopping sight distance, and these values are used in designing of highways. So factors affecting SSD. So what are the factors affecting stopping sight distance? So there are some factors which influencing stopping sight distance, that is total reaction time of the driver, speed of the vehicle, efficiency of brakes, frictional resistance between road and tire, gradient of road. So let us see one by one. So first let us see total reaction time. So total reaction time is the time taken from the instant the object is visible to the driver to instant the brake is effectively applied. So reaction time of a driver is time taken from instant of the object is visible to the driver to instant when the brake are applied. So here the total reaction time may be split into two parts. One is perception time and reaction time. So first one is perception time. So perception time is the time from the instant the object comes on the line of sight of a driver to instant he realizes that the vehicle needs to be stopped. So here in the perception time, when a driver sees an object in when he is moving on a road surface, then at that instant the message will be sent to his brain and he will think that the vehicle has to be stopped, and this time is called as perception time. And the second one is reaction time or brake reaction time. So the brake reaction also depends on several factors including the skill of driver, the type of problem and various other environment factors. Total reaction time of a driver can be calculated by PIEV theory. So the reaction time or brake reaction time is dependent upon the skill of driver, type of problem and various environmental factor. So here the brake reaction time can be analyzed by PIEV theory. So what is this PIEV theory? Let us see that. So PIEV theory, total reaction time of a driver is split into four parts, that is P stands for perception, I for intellection, E for emotion and V for violation. So here in this figure you can see, so P means it is perception time, It is the time required for sensation received by the eye or eyes of a driver to transmit it to the brain through the nervous system and spinal cord. In other words, we can tell that time required to perceive an object or situation. So here what happens? When a driver sees some object or any other vehicle is coming from the opposite direction, the message will be immediately sent to the brain through a spinal cord. So that is perception. So intelligence is the time required for the driver to understand the situation. So once the message is sent to the brain, then he should analyze the situation and he should understand what is the thing that he has to do. So it is also the time required for comparing the difference through and regrouping and registering new sensations. So here you should think what you should do. Next is emotion. So it is the time elapsed during emotion, sensations and other mental disturbances such as fear and angry. So here, if a driver is a very short-tempered person, so he may not be in a position to handle the condition. He will be tensed and he may apply the accelerator instead of brake, or he may increase the speed, or he may suddenly apply the brake. So that is emotion of a driver. So last one is violation. It is the time taken by the driver for the final action. So in the first step, that is in perception, whenever a driver sees object or a vehicle in front of him, the message will be sent to the brain, and there the driver will think what he should do, and he will analyze the situation, that is intellection. And the third one is emotion. So after analyzing the situation, he will think what he should do, whether if he is a short-tempered person, he will be fear or he will be in anger, so that he may increase the speed or he may apply the brake suddenly. So that is the thinking what is going in his mind. And the last one is violation, which is the time taken by the driver for the final action. So here he will think what to do, and here he will execute his plan. That is, whether he should apply the brake or he should increase the speed or he should decrease the speed, that is violation. So this is how the PIEV theory is explained, and this is how the total reaction time is explained. So perception, time required for sensation received by the eye or eye to be transmitted to the brain through nervous system. So intellection, emotion and violation. So here the total reaction time of a driver may vary from 0.5 seconds to 4 seconds. So the driver may take a time of 0.5 seconds to 4 seconds to analyze the condition and to execute the problem. So the second factor influencing stopping sight distance is speed of vehicle. So here the stopping distance depends very much on speed of vehicle. How it depends on speed of vehicle? See, during the total reaction time of the driver, the distance moved by the vehicle will depend on the speed. So second is the braking distance, or the distance moved by the vehicle after applying the brakes before coming to rest, also depends on the initial speed of the vehicles. Hence we can tell that higher speed will be having higher stopping distance and lower speed will be having less stopping distance. So third factor influencing stopping sight distance is efficiency of brakes. Here the efficiency of brakes depend upon the age of vehicle, vehicle characteristics, etc. If the brake efficiency is 100%, then the vehicle will stop the moment the brakes are applied. But to be practical, it is not possible to achieve 100% brake efficiency. Therefore, that sight distance required will be more than the efficiency of a brake. The fourth factor influencing stopping sight distance is frictional resistance between tire and road. The friction resistance between tire and road plays an important role to bring the vehicle to a stop. So when the friction resistance is more, the vehicle will stop immediately. Thus, sight distance required is very less. So here, no provision is made for brake efficiency while computing the stopping sight distance. This is taken into account along with the factor of longitudinal friction. So as per IRC recommendation, the value of longitudinal friction between 0.35 to 0.4 is considered while designing a highway. And the last factor influencing the stopping sight distance is gradient of a road. Here the gradient of road also affects the sight distance. While climbing up a gradient, the vehicle can stop immediately. Therefore, the sight distance required is less. When we consider descending gradient, the gravity also comes into action and more time will be required to stop the vehicle. Hence, the stopping sight distance required while climbing up gradient is less, whereas the stopping sight distance required for a steep pavement will be more. The next one is analysis of stopping sight distance. So how analyze stopping sight distance? So here the stopping sight distance is nothing but it is the sum of lag distance and the braking distance. So lag distance is nothing but it is the distance the vehicle traveled during the reaction time. So lag distance is the distance which is traveled by the vehicle during the reaction time of a driver. So here if V is the design speed in meter per second and T is the total reaction time of the driver in seconds, then lag distance is equal to V into T in meters, where V is in meter per second and T is in seconds. And here the lag distance is equal to 0.278 V into T meters, where V is in kmps. So here V is in meter per second and here V is in kilometer per hour and time is in second. So that is lag distance. And now braking distance. So assuming the road to be level, let us assume the road is level. So in such condition, what is braking distance? So it is the distance traveled by the vehicle after application of brake. So if the road is level and a driver has applied the brake, so even after applying the brake, the vehicle will move for some distance. So the distance which is moved by the vehicle is called as braking distance. So here the braking distance is obtained by equating work done in stopping the vehicle and kinetic energy of the vehicle. So work done against the frictional force in stopping the vehicle is F into I, where F is friction and I is the distance traveled by the vehicle. So this is equal to F into W into I, where F is frictional coefficient and W is weight of the vehicle. So we know the relation that frictional coefficient is equal to F by W, or frictional coefficient is defined as the ratio of friction to weight of the body. Therefore, friction can be written as frictional coefficient into weight of the vehicle, where W is total weight of the vehicle, and the kinetic energy at design speed of V meter per second will be half into mv square. Therefore, the braking distance is equal to v square by 2gf. So the total stop sight distance that has to be provided is equal to lag distance plus braking distance, where lag distance is 0.278 v into t plus braking distance, that is v square by 254f, where g is gravity due to acceleration. So So here in this table you can see coefficient of longitudinal frictions for different speed limit. So coefficient of longitudinal friction for 30 kmph is 0.4, for 40 it is 0.38, like that for 50, 60, and for the speed greater than 80, the coefficient of lateral longitudinal friction is given. So next, coming to overtaking sight distance. So it is the minimum distance open to vision of the driver of a vehicle intending to overtake slow moving vehicle ahead with safety against the traffic of opposite direction is known as minimum overtaking sight distance. The overtaking distance, or OSD, is the distance measured along the center of the road which a driver with his eye level 1.2 meter above the road surface can see the top of an object 1.2 meter above the road surface. So overtaking sight distance means it is a minimum distance which is available for a vehicle to overtake a slow moving vehicle. So the vehicle which is overtaking a slow moving vehicle, so overtaking sight distance means it is a distance which is provided for a fast moving vehicle to overtake the slow moving vehicle by considering the vehicle which is coming in opposite direction. So next is the factors affecting OSD. What are the factors affecting overtaking sight distance? So the first one is speed. So speed means we are going to consider the speed of overtaking vehicle, overtaken vehicle, and the vehicle which is coming from the opposite direction, if any. So if the speed of overtaking vehicle is more, and if the speed of overtaken vehicle is less, then the driver should check the speed of the vehicle which is coming in the opposite direction, if there is any. Then the distance between overtaking and overtaken vehicle, skill and reaction time of the driver, rate of acceleration of overtaking vehicle, gradient of the road. So these are the factors affecting OSD, that is overtaking sight distance. The distance between overtaking vehicle and overtaken vehicle should be minimum, or else this may lead to collision. And skill and reaction time of the driver should be quick. So the rate of acceleration of overtaking vehicle, if there is increase in the acceleration rate of the overtaking vehicle, then the time taken to overtake the slow moving vehicle will be less. If the rate of acceleration is more of overtaking vehicle, then the overtaking time taken by the vehicle to overtake slow moving vehicle will be more. And gradient of road, if the gradient of road is having a steep gradient, then the overtaking vehicle will move fast. If the gradient is higher, if the gradient is higher, then the overtaking vehicle speed will be less and the time taken by the overtaking vehicle will be more. So here in this slide, let us see how the analysis of overtaking sight distance is done. So here in this figure, we can see A1, A2, B1, B2 and A3. So here, A1 is nothing but it is the first position of a overtaking vehicle. So let us consider a vehicle A is having a high speed and vehicle B is having a lower speed. So here the vehicle A is overtaking the vehicle B. So this is the first position of the vehicle A1. So A1 is the first position of the vehicle A before it is overtaking the vehicle B. And this is the second position of the vehicle A, that is A2. And this is the position of vehicle B. So here, when the vehicle A comes to the position A2, it will move towards right and it will overtake the vehicle B by checking the vehicle which is coming from the opposite direction, and as soon as the vehicle A overtakes vehicle B, it will again take left deviation and it will move to its regular lane. So here D1 is the distance traveled by overtaking vehicle A during the reaction time t second of the driver from position A1 to A2. D2 is the distance traveled by vehicle A from A2 to A3 during the actual overtaking operation in time t second. D3 is the distance traveled by oncoming vehicle C from C1 to C2 during overtaking operation of A, that is in t second. So this is the distance traveled by the vehicle which is coming in opposite direction. So the opposite vehicle, let us consider as C. So the vehicle C has moved to C1, then from C1 to C2. So the distance traveled by a vehicle from position C1 to C2 be D3. So B is the overtaken or slow moving vehicle. So the vehicle B is overtaken or slow moving vehicle moving with uniform speed VB meter per second or VB kilometer per hour. So C is the vehicle coming from opposite direction at design speed V meter per second or V kmph. Therefore, the distance traveled by the vehicle A during this reaction time is D1, and and is between the position A1 and A2, this distance will be equal to VB into T, where T is the reaction time of a driver and it is usually taken as 2 seconds. So this is how we will analyze OSD, that is overtaking sight distance. Now coming to the calculation part. Overtaking sight distance is equal to D1 plus D2 plus D3. So you can see the distance, total distance traveled by the vehicle A to overtake B, which is called as overtaking distance. Yes, the vehicle has traveled from A1 to A2, that is D1, then from A2 to A3, that is D2, and from A3 to next position, which is parallel to C1, and that distance is D3. So the total distance of overtaking is equal to D1 plus D2 plus D3. So OSD, overtaking sight distance, is equal to 0.28 VB into T plus 0.28 VB into T plus 2S plus 0.28 into V into T. So where S is the spacing of wheels, which is equal to 0.2 VB plus 6. Therefore, T is equal to square root of 4 into 3 into 6S divided by A, which is equal to 14.4S divided by A. So, if the speed of overtaken vehicle is not given, then we can consider VB is equal to V minus 16 kmph, where V is speed of overtaking vehicle in kmph. The minimum overtaking sight distance is equal to D1 plus D2 plus D3 for two-way traffic. If it is a two-way traffic, then the minimum overtaking sight distance is D1 plus D2 plus D3. So D1 plus D2 is the distance of vehicle A, and D3 is the distance of vehicle C. And we are going to consider this distance because the vehicle A3 will be moving to the distance which is parallel to C1, and we are going to consider that distance. Suppose if it is a one-way traffic, then the overtaking distance is D1 plus D2 because it is a one-way traffic and no vehicle will be coming from the opposite direction, hence D3 does not exist. So next up, we shall see what is overtaking zone. So it is desirable to construct highways in such a way that the length of road visible ahead at every point is sufficient for safe overtaking. This is seldom practicable and there may be stretches where a safe overtaking distance can't be provided. In such zones where overtaking or passing is not safe or it is not possible, signposts should be installed indicating no passing or overtaking prohibited before such restricted zone starts. The zones which are meant for overtaking are called as overtaking zones. So it is a good practice in the construction of highway to provide a overtaking zones for a fast moving vehicles. So if there is no possibilities to provide overtaking zones, then a board has to be placed there like no passing or overtaking is prohibited. The zone which is provided to overtake the slow moving vehicles is called as overtaking zones. So here the overtaking opportunity for vehicle moving at design speed should be given as a frequent interval as possible. These zones which are meant for overtaking are called as overtaking zones. So here in this figure you can see the overtaking zones. So the figure shows an overtaking zone with specification for the position of signposts. So signposts should be installed at sufficient distance in advance to indicate the start and end of overtaking zones. And here the minimum length of overtaking zone should be 3 times the safe overtaking side distance and desirable length should be 5 times the OSD. In this figure you can see. So here it is a S1. So S1 is nothing but it is the beginning of overtaking zone. So it is OSD. It is a overtaking sight distance. So here the overtaking zone begins and this is the overtaking sight distance. And here the width of road is more. So this is provided to facilitate the overtaking procedure. And the widening of the length of the widening of this pavement or road should be 3 to 5 times that of OSD, that is 3 to 5 times that of overtaking sight distance. And here S2 indicates end of overtaking sight distance. Similarly on this side for the vehicle which is moving in the other direction, here S1 represents the overtaking zone starts for the vehicle which is coming in this direction and this is the overtaking sight distance. And here also the width of pavement is more to facilitate the overtaking operation. So the length of this increased width of pavement is 3 to 5 times of this OSD and here it is S2 where the overtaking zone ends. So this is how the overtaking zones are designed and it is constructed. Now coming to the next in a sight distance, that is sight distance at intersection. The driver entering an uncontrolled intersection has sufficient visibility to enable him to take control of his vehicle and to avoid collision with other vehicles. So at intersection what will happen? A driver who is approaching from one direction will not be able to see the vehicle which is approaching from the other direction at an angle of 90 degree or at an angle of 60 or 40 degree. So it is said that in designing of highway, a minimum sight distance at intersection should be provided such that it is very important that on all the approaches of intersecting roads, a clear view across the commerce from a sufficient distance should be provided so that we can avoid the collision of vehicles. So here the design of sight distance at intersections may be based on 3 conditions. One is enabling the approaching vehicle to change the speed, enabling approaching vehicle to stop, enabling stop vehicle to cross main road. So these 3 things or these 3 conditions can be controlled by providing a proper signal facility at the intersection. So next sight distance is intermediate sight distance. So intermediate sight distance is defined as twice the stopping sight distance. So when overtaking sight distance cannot be provided, intermediate sight distance is provided to give a limited overtaking opportunities to fast moving vehicles. So here due to some problem like unavailability of road, or it may not be possible to increase the width of road. So in such conditions, we cannot provide safe overtaking sight distances. So in such condition, we are going to provide intermediate sight distance where twice the stopping sight distance is provided. And here, a limited overtaking opportunity is provided for the fast moving vehicle, provided if there is no vehicle coming from opposite direction. And the last type of sight distance is headlight sight distance. So this is the distance visible to driver during night driving under the illumination of vehicle headlights. This sight distance is critical at up gradients and at ascending steps of valley curves. So the vehicle which will be traveling during the night time, their sight distance depends upon the headlight. So up to what distance the headlight is falling, up to that point a driver can be able to see the road. So this sight distance is very critical during up gradients and at the valley curves.